So let me start by asking you a simple question to each one of you. Who are we? I am not asking that philosophical question, who am I? Main kaun hoon? That is answered by our rishis. I'm not asking that. This is a simple, lively question for every engineer or every scientist. We need to know who are we? Are we engineers? Or are we the technologists? Or are we the just educationists? Or are we the students? Or are we the human beings first and everything else after that? This is a big question. So this consciousness is very important in today's era. So I must tell you why this. Because, my dear friends, we literally are what we eat and where we live. Two things are very important. So we literally are what we eat and where we live. So this is the most important consciousness we must have today. So it goes without saying environmental conditions and determine how human genes are expressed. Everything from the food we eat to the landscape we inhabit are epigenetic factors that shape up with our genes and are activated to give us a unique physical and psychological characteristics. So those who understand genomics can say with authority that genetic variations are the causes of many deadly diseases we see around, or humans losses the immunity due to these genetic mutations or changes. That is what we are facing in the last 1.5 years due to this corona or COVID. It can also shape the progression of diseases like cancer, maybe COVID, and influence child development and aging. So in short, landscapes play an even a greater role in shaping human health than previously what we understood. This is the basic lesson what we are learning. So today's topic of role of engineers for a sustainable planet is not just a topic to dwell into your career ambitions. If there are some students who are listening, of course there could be possibility, but it is not just another topic for a PhD paper or not just an avenue for celebrating an engineer's day. It is something that can influence the living or the life of all creatures in this universe, including you, me, or I will say nobody can escape from the impact of what we eat and where we live. Everyone is impacted by this. So what better topic could be discussed on this day, my dear budding engineers, those who are listening me? Because I know GJU, Guru Jambesh University, is one of the best technical universities in this part of the country. We are all benchmarking with the Guru Jambeshwar in many areas to improve ourselves. So all these students who are listening me, this is important. So you can design nuclear stations, rocket engines that can half the traveling to moon. Maybe better hyperloops may come with products using AI, artificial intelligence, or machine learning to mimic human brain in the coming time, or even mind for tomorrow. It can come tomorrow. And something like in my school days, I learned in all in South, so I learned a Bible quote which says, "For what profits a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul?" So that is very important. There is no point in losing the soul and gaining something else. Similarly, what gain are we talking if we are designing better gadgets, instruments, and machineries, but loses the beauty and delicate fabric of where we inhabit? So remember again, my dear friends, we are what we eat and what we breathe and what we live. This is what makes all of us. So let me take you into a sustainable engineering first, which you definitely understand. It is the process of designing or operating systems such that they use energy and resources sustainably. Or in other words, at a rate that does not compromise the natural environment or the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Simply saying, sustainable engineering is designed by thinking, of future generations. And today we also talk about all related to design by thinking or design by nature. So not their greed, today's design is not their greed or comfort, but what they eat and where they live is more important. So as engineers, we have the huge responsibility of designing almost everything that is there in this world. Not just building and plants, we design the transporting systems, mobile phones, MRI machines, utensils, pen and pencils. We hold on to even a minute pin and clips. Everything, there is a hand of an engineer behind it. It is the engineers who visualize all these design it and produce them. So I must say, every human being who is capable of designing anything to that works efficiently is an engineer. It has nothing to do with a particular qualification or stamping of a B.Tech or M.Tech or M.E. or a Ph.D. So even a bird who built its nest to be hanged on a tree is an engineer, according to me. If you look at the honeycomb, the way it designs, it's such a beautiful design. 5,000 years ago, they have done it such a... Today, architects are looking at it to the nature and learn how to design such a honeycomb. So all these are important at this point of time. So when we design something, what shall come first to our mind? For quite some time, it was cost, efficiency, speed, aesthetics. All these were talking, nothing else. But the bigger question in today's world is, are they enough? The answer is an emphatic no. First and foremost, we must realize again and again, because I'm repeating it here, because it should go to the brain of every student who listens to me. We are what we eat and where we live. It's very important. So think of nature first and this planet first. That is the concept of design by nature. Almost all over the developed country, they are all in this line. This explains the role of engineers for a sustainable planet. So in the context of climate change and the many recent hurricanes, earthquakes, and wildfires, designers must be cognizant of the lessons of nature. Designers or engineers cannot simply resist these human and nature-induced forces, but instead need to intervene in ways that account for and respond to them. This could mean choosing not to build somewhere, choosing to build differently somewhere, or just taking the long view over short-term fixes. Perhaps the signs have long been there to design in this way, but turning to nature should empower designers to heed their call. To design with the nature today means to survey the history of nature and getting inspired by it. Now, more than ever, to design with nature, we must listen and respond to the experiences we see in the daily life. We must learn to see nature as a breadth of living systems. The flora and fauna that inhabit our world and the climate and the resources that are intrinsic to a resilient and productive planet. And just as we relate with one another, we interact with our environment intuitively, emotionally, and intellectually. We directly shape the designed and manufactured environments we live within, while indirectly influencing the feral environment beyond. We actively change, willfully neglect, and at times attempt to preserve or restore nature. Our work embodies our values and our connection to the world and one another. By striving to advance the interplay and respect between ourselves and nature, we can encourage generosity, offer inspiration, and embody rational functionality within the constructed environment. As engineers, we must respect land, water, and vegetation. This respect must be the basis of our career. Our goal and our job is to inform and educate our clients, officials, colleagues, community, and our students of the basic principles from design with nature. And if education does not work for this, it is our responsibility to advocate loudly for sustainable design, at least now. So now that technology has advanced and a more powerful data-based tool is available than ever before, we can model natural process and outcomes as never before. And I always believe humans are the most complex and amazing design and engineering or technology that creator has ever created and ever existed in this planet. Think of how our heart circulates blood all over the body parts. Those who understand the flow valves must know how complex it a system is, how the neural systems are wired. Can anyone design such a system? How flexibly your arm and legs turns and moves? Have anyone has a better gadget than a human hand? Can a robotic hand move so flexibly and with fineness? Every scientist is looking at human in nature to mimic what, how it functions and how it works. If humans are made with a sustainable concept, this is an important concept I want to communicate. Yesterday, it took me half an hour to get into this point because what I should speak to these kids who are listening to me. If humans are with the made with a sustainable concept, why must not make everything else the same way? Whatever we are designing, we don't bother. Such a complex body of human, which is sustainable, creator has created in such a way. And humans, after we ease our life in this earth, we just get composed in weeks. Only our bones take little more time to decay. So this pancha bhutas, what we talk about, prithvi, tejo, vayu, akash, how the disintegration is happening, we all know. So this is the principle we have to impart in every design which we look into. Think how the nature has designed our body. While doing all it is intended function that lasts for 7 to 8 decades with the minimum maintenance, all of it just decay in 30 days or so. The simple plastic bags produced by us cannot decay even after a decade. They just becoming a big heap all around. Think again for this. Does the pen and a small pin you use can be composted or not? It's a big question we have to ask ourselves. So the point I make here is very, very simple. We must engineer by keeping nature in our mind always for the future generations in our consciousness. When we start working, we must think of sustainability, wastages it produces, the impact it leaves on this planet Earth, what we eat and what we live. That's why I want to propagate this question, which I just put day before yesterday. What we eat and what we live is the question we have to ask ourselves all the time. We must start design for zero wastage. Those who know additive manufacturing now, one of the 9 technologies of Industry 4.0, Japanese are already moved to Society 5.0, the next level, where they talk about nature only. The future of manufacturing proposes production with zero waste or minimum waste. It uses the powders or material that is not used again, recycled and reused. Likewise, we need more such manufacturing methods and processes. I have said and enough and more about design by nature, sustainability and zero waste, etc. You must be wondering, is this practical? Does anyone or any industry practices this? Yes. Industries are following this now, some more diligently than others. One such industry, what I can explain is my own industry, that is printing and packaging, because I cannot give you any examples of other industry. I can cite something from my own industry, how we are working in our field. I am a printing engineer, as I told you, or as introduced by Madam Srivastava. I earned everything in my life by being a proud printer or a proud printing packaging engineer and as a teacher. And for all my achievements, I bow my head to my industry. My respect is and gratitude is to my industry. So there are greater misconceptions about my industry. This is what I want to bring you today as a very special topic from my industry, which is integral part of all of our life. We use the benefits of printing, packaging and paper, each one of us, more than you use mobile phones or a Google. You may not be conscious about it. From the very moment you wake up to going retire to the bed for the day in the night, you come across printing, paper and packaging at every touch point. Let us see the sustainable practices, some of them what we printing engineers practice for a while. How many of you think that paper is made from trees that grows in a forest? We see every day that in the emails we receive that to love this nature, you shall not print this. By reducing paper use, you are becoming more responsible to nature. Let me explain the truth. It is totally wrong. It is not possible for you to go to a forest and cut some trees and make a paper. It is not possible. It's like farming an industry. It is just like how you cultivate wheat, all the crops like wheat or rice or anything else, or that matter like sugarcane. Can you say, nobody will tell that how many hectares of sugarcane farming you are cutting every year. Nobody cry about it. But when it comes to paper, everyone talks like you are going to cut the forest and spoil. My dear friends, it's a long, wrong misconception. It's a complete misconception. Reason being, you cannot go to a forest and cut a tree and do make a paper. You have to plant it. And for plantation, you need separate place. Reclimated land they are doing. ITC is doing project. Balarpur Industries here in our own state, they are doing these projects. So by doing this, actually you are serving the environment. This is what I want to share with you. So by reducing paper, you are becoming more responsible to, I mean, using paper. And paper is one of the few truly sustainable products. Paper is based on wood and natural and renewable material. As young trees grow, they absorb a lot of CO2 and produce a lot of oxygen. Furthermore, a wood product paper also continues to store carbon throughout its lifetime. So it is completely recyclable, compostable, making it most sustainable material. You can't compare the carbon footprint or environmental hazards created by plastic or e-waste or impact of a digital communication over the planet. So the first misconception is sourcing of paper. Can anyone imagine ever going to a forest and cutting this? This is what I was trying to tell you. So when a farmer who cultivates paper, he is running a family. Lakhs and lakhs of farmers in this country, they are surviving just like a wheat farmer, just like a rice farmer, he is running a family. So it's an ecosystem. It's not just spoiling the nature at all. So if at all anybody is talking about this, it is completely wrong. And once you print something on a paper, you don't need any further energy at all. You can keep it for one generation, two generation. I have a Bhagavad Gita, which is 300 years old. I can still read it. There is no energy loss at all. But every time when I open my mobile phone, every time I open my laptop, my energy consumption is same. I am spoiling. I am producing carbon. So I am producing CO2. So that is not the right way to do. So we have to do support these farmers, in fact. So just take the example of ITC, Paper Boat Company, total plantation as of March 31st, 2021, stand over 8.78 million acres, which is a reclaimed land. So that produces a lot of oxygen. So they are enabling small farmers to earn sustainable livelihood from unproductive land holdings. It is just like you just see most of these items which we produce, like whatever vegetable you use, it is not natural. We never bother about it. You cannot go to a forest and get some bhindi or bengan. It's not possible to get. Man has created it for ourselves. It is an artificial product which we produce. And today you think that it is what natural which has come. It's not like that. We produced it. So same way, sugarcane, rice. You can't go to a forest and get some rice. You have to cultivate it. You have to do it. You have to spend a lot of energy and water. That's the same thing in this. So this is the way we have to change our thinking process. So a survey conducted in Europe is very interesting. 65% believe the European forests are shrinking, but that is wrong. In fact, they are growing in size. You look at the history of Delhi today, you see the picture of Delhi 50 years ago and today, you will see Delhi's greenery has tremendously improved. Just by seeing the picture, you can see. This UN was actually thanking India for improving the green and vegetation, what we are doing now. And in 8% in Europe were believed that paper recycling rate is something like 60, but that is not true. It is 72%. The newspaper, what you read, every newsprint is 6 times recycled. It's a recycled paper. There is nothing to worry about. So this is very important. We all have to think about all this. So this rules implies to almost all industries, whichever industry you are belongs to. So you have to think of it and how we can improve it. This is very much thought. This should be the thought process of today for all these engineers coming from different branches of engineering. I also just want to give you some examples as highlights from other industry, which could be sensible to all these listeners. Coca-Cola has declared that they intended to make 100% of their packaging recyclable globally by 2025. I am not marketing for Coca-Cola to drink, but the thought process what they are taking, you don't need to drink Coca-Cola at all. It is up to you. But use at least 50% recycled material in our packaging by 2030, they have taken. Nestle is doing 100% of its packaging recycled by 2025. Unilever has announced that by 2025, they will half the use of virgin plastic what they use, by reducing our absolute use of plastic packaging by more than 100,000 tons and ensure that 100% plastic packaging is designed to be fully reusable, recyclable and compostable. So this is what the way the industries are changing. And if you read the book of this Harari on 21 lessons for the 21st century, we know that AI is going to play a big, big role in the coming time, where also the first focus, one of the focus he has given is on consciousness, how we can improve it, how we can bring it. So the thought process of every engineer today should be like the land where we live is not gifted by your grandparents, not by your grandfather or by your father. It is a land which we have borrowed from our grandchildren. So we all have the responsibility to give it back intact in the coming time. That's very clear. This is what we have to keep in mind. So as an engineer, any activity you do, anything you design, always look at nature and design with nature. Go with nature. Never ever go against nature. Again, remembering all these, what our forefathers, great, great rishis, what they talked about our nature. Never ever go against nature. In Bharat, we taught only one thing to every people. Never ever don't try to do anything against nature. Once I remember in 70s or 80s, somebody was talking about Ganga pollution projects. So Ganga cleaning project, when it was started, Swami Chinmayananda said, you don't need to talk about Ganga cleaning project. Instead, you talk about a project where you say Ganga non-polluting project. Ganga Mata know how to clean herself, which we have seen in the COVID period. Within 2 months' time, Ganga has become so clean. Ganga Mata has become so clean. It know how to clean up herself. We don't need. So the project is more of how to non-pollute the Ganga. So the thinking process should be something like this. So I have to tell this, friends, like, always remember the planet Earth where we live is not gifted by your father or not gifted by your grandfather. It is borrowed from your grandchildren, and we all have the responsibility to give it back intact to them. So with that oath today, I want to conclude thanking all of you for giving me an opportunity to share my thought process here, and have a safe time ahead. Thank you so much.